Let me first talk about the RTMA and the IRMA package. So, usual topics for me. I'm going to defer and let the developers talk a little more, talk more about the update. Big things here, we unified the terrain across the RTMA and IRMA. They're doing that across the blend and all the inputs to the blend. We've added IRMA for Hawaii and Puerto Rico and some other additions. Like I said, I will let the developers speak to that. We also did an update to the NAM Smart Init. A lot of it was also infrastructure updates, but you can see here there's a list of a lot of new fields, making some changes to what's available at what hours. So here's our quad. The RTMA, for better or for worse, we hooked it up with the RAP and the HER, and so we won't do that again because the RTMA has its own players in the NSET production suite that they go with and that are dependent on it, and we should just let them go in on their own and sink or swim alone. So a lot of some of the delay you see in this quad is because we tied it to the RAP and HER and had to coordinate those timelines. In terms of implementation efficiency, again, the 155 days is a little misleading, although they did take advantage of the delays to maybe add in a little more than what they might have if we had gone with them originally when they delivered code, but that is the nature of the business. So we did have several code changes once we got the code, working with standards, fixing something in the terrain, a couple other things listed here. Again, did some good compliance to the standards, but there are some things we've identified that we hope to see get even better next time. No restart on the parallel, which is nice. Analysis of compute resources, no real changes here for the RTMA and IRMA. Runtime's comparable. In terms of data dissemination, no real changes here. A little bit of an uptick on the FTP server due to the new grid. Nothing radical here. Same for the IRMA. And then in terms of the evaluations, again, I'll let the users speak for themselves a little bit more, but you know, basically the feedback we got was positive, supportive of the implementation. They noted a couple things about, you know, an issue there with the terrain in one particular area, but I know that is an ongoing conversation. Hawaii and Puerto Rico, very useful, particularly for as inputs to the blends or use in the blends. So, in general, positive feedback. So, the RTMA and IRMA, it is all of these models we're talking about today are staying on phase two. We're not at the Cray yet, and no issues of note here from the IT side. Okay, let me do my other one next, and then I'll let others talk, and then we'll ask you, when we go around for the feedback, we'll ask you each to comment on anything in the package. I can't see. There we go. All right, so now we've got the combined RAP and HER. So here's a slide that shows a lot of the changes. The items at the top are, because they are so intertwined, these are changes that were made to both of them with the GSI, going to WRF code 361, microphysics, boundary layer. And then we list some of the specific to the HER and then specific to the RAP. Another item of interest, great interest to the field, is the extension of the forecast length. Going out to 18 hours now with the HER and 21 hours with the RAP. So again, I'll let EMC tell you more about that. The quad for the RAP and HER, I'll say we've been talking about this quad for a long time, but we got the code, we started working on it. The other thing I'll note on this one that I think gave us some trouble, because both of these models ended up in the hands of our analysts on the supercomputer, and to me the issue here was EMC did not have the resources to run real-time parallels of these models on the system before they handed them off to us. And I believe that some of these issues we found once NCO had the code, they may have revealed them more if they were able to run more real-time. I don't believe there were development resources given to them, they were given to other models. So we made an agreement that we would take it with as much testing as they have been able to do, and go from there. So that's just my one comment. Next time, these models have to run in real time by the development group for a period of time before they get handed off.
So did we agree to do the final testing, developmental testing on our side? That was a conscious decision?
We agreed to be the first ones that watched it every cycle, every day.
They had done
all the testing and everything, and they had run through it. It just, they couldn't.
All that was a conscious decision. It wasn't portrayed as clean code that had been fully tested.
Right. When we had the EMCCCB, they presented it to us, and then we all agreed to use GSD's runs for the scientific, and then they did a comparison. EMC did a comparison and said, yes, look, our numbers are identical to GSD.
Okay.
The same code.
We could only run every other cycle of the HER in parallel. Otherwise, they backed up badly.
Right.
And we actually moved from phase two to phase one because when the GFS was running their testing on phase two, we could not get run through. The RAP we got through pretty much every cycle.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's one of the things, the five-year plan.
Yeah.
We tried to move things away from each other so that they would get enough room on the machine to do their tasks for them. Okay, implementation efficiency, a lot of code updates. We just got a lot. So like I said, the 30-day went very smoothly. Getting to the 30-day, it took us a lot of back and forth. And again, some of this, like I said, we had to pull in the analysts on WCOS because we had some weird behavior, some failures in the code that, we just needed to pull the analysts in, and the runtime was slower on phase two than it had been on phase one, but we worked through all of that.
So this is a long list, and I don't want to go into it here, but I'm going to call a separate meeting so I better understand why this list is so long. Is it associated with the availability of compute resources for EMC testing? Is it associated with the delivery of the code? I just want a separate meeting with Kevin Kelleher, myself, Stan Benjamin, Jeff DeMago, Jeff Mannequin, and Ben to understand this. Okay?
Okay.
So I don't want to go through it here. But that's a long list of stuff for delivery on 22 of February.
Okay.
I know it's complex, but separate meeting. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Okay. So here's our compute resource. Again, this is going to stay on phase two. That's where the HER is now. Doubling of the resources for the HER for this upgrade. Runtime is comparable, though. So part of it's the additional forecast hours, but that's what it is.
So the additional forecast only going from 15 hours to 18 hours, right? And the resolution is the same. Why double?
It's bigger, and there's more physics.
Right.
The
microphysics, more extensive.
Yeah.
Okay. For the RAP, we added about 30 nodes per hourly cycle here. And
that's
again,
mostly for the expanded domain.
Runtime's comparable again. Okay, data dissemination plan for the HER, a lot of increase. One of the things is we went to direct GRIB2 output, and the packing scheme changes when we do that, and so there was an increase, just a technical increase there. But you're also seeing the additional forecast hours. We do have the sub-hourly, but that will not go to AWIPS initially. We need to do testing with the NCS. The additional forecast hours and the additional variables will be on the SBN next week, whenever we implement. Then on the RAP, similar thing. The RAP actually had the most increase in size because of the GRIB2 transition. So we worked with AWIPS and let them know that was coming.
And the expanded domain.
But again, you will get the additional forecast hours of the RAP on the SBN, and we are adding the Puerto Rico grid.
So I assume there was a science reason to build or keep configuration back sometime ago.
So the question asks is the decision-making process. What what was the driving factor behind increasing the size of the grid? And I think it was the ensemble.
We've got a slide on
it. Okay, you've got it. Okay, all right.
Okay, so again, a lot of feedback and evaluation on both this whole package, which we'll let folks talk about. But again, positive feedback. Yes, they want the additional forecast hours. Yes, the expansion of the domain is good. Improvements in some of the things we were looking to see improvements in. The snow cover, obviously we did our 30-day during the summer, so no real feedback on that, not surprising. But they were able to evaluate that through GSD's runs earlier in the year. So it's bigger, but it fits on phase two, and from our perspective, we are good to go. So next, let's do the RTMA. I can see it. Where is it? There it is. There you go.
All right.
I don't know if you need that or not.
It's on. All right. Yeah. Ooh. Came out wrong when I did when it went from drive to PowerPoint. I'm sorry. There's quite a bit here. This is just an overview. As Becky said, we were able to get some quick fixes that were requested by the field after our handoff. And one of the main improvements with this upgrade is the new background, RAP V3 and HER V2, because we use those. Their downscaled output to generate the background. Improvements in moisture and temperature allowed for a better background field, and we also have a few spurious features that have been removed. Here's one of them. This came to us from the zoo in Corpus Christi, Mike Buchanan. You can see the small cold pool there near the METAR op that should not be there with a new parallel. It's not there. NAM Smart in it, which Becky mentioned, and Annette Gibbs did most of the work on this. The new terrain and land sea mask, which I'll get to in a minute, the grid was expanded westward for future RTMA upgrade purposes. Also cloud ceiling and mean sea level pressure were added to the output. Just a quick look at what it looks like. You can see the grid expanded to the west in the new version here. This is a temperature output. I put more plots in the backup. The consensus terrain and land sea mask, this is something that Brian Mirdsky and Dave Myrick have been working a lot on. This is the new mask generated by MDL. This was in originally with the handoff, and shortly after handoff, we got feedback from the WFO in Salt Lake City about the size of Great Salt Lake, which it changed. It's apparently at a historically low level now. We were able to work with Jeff Wagner and George Gano to improve that, and the size of the lake is now much closer to what to reality. And I have some graphics for that in the backup, but again, with time, I wanted to get through this quickly. IRMA for Hawaii and Puerto Rico, this was requested by MDL for the national blend. This was pretty simple. It's the same code we used for CONUS in Alaska that we implemented back in January. More observations are used, and also min and max temperature. This is a plot of just the number of observations used. I know this valley here is noticeable. That happened when there was a hardware failure, I believe, at GSD, so we stopped getting MADIS Mesonet data, and I believe a switch was made to get the data from IDP. So we're still getting, so that recovery took place. But you can see clearly many more data being used, at least in Hawaii anyway. The max temperature, this is just a quick look comparing 2 hours. The high on this particular date, this was from last week, and the high in Hawaii, at Honolulu anyway, happened to be around 0057Z, so that's the 1Z temperature analysis versus the max T analysis. You can see they're fairly similar. I have a difference plot in the backup slides if you want to look at that. Wind speed analysis. This is a request we got from the WFOs, particularly after looking at a specific case in West Virginia. They asked for a direct analysis of wind speed. The idea was that this would get a better fit to observations, and we also found that with the method we're using now, which uses stream function and velocity potential, we found features showing up that should not have been there, which I'll demonstrate real quickly. This is the case that led us to actually make this change. The you can see the area of fairly large wind speed here over West Virginia. That shouldn't be there. There are no observations supporting that. The background did not support that. Something happened with the correlation links to cause that. When we put in the new direct wind speed analysis, you can see this bullseye no longer exists. And again, I put in the backup how well this matches the individual observations. It is a much better match, and we got some good feedback from Eastern Region and the WFO in Charleston, West Virginia, to be specific. These are cross-validation stats for the new wind speed method. You can see there is only a slight improvement in the average RMSE. The point I'm trying to get here is that even though the stats don't necessarily show that much of an improvement, the feedback that we've gotten from the field has told us that this is very important.
So what's the sample size?
This was over a 31-day period. This was 35, excuse me, from early July to early August.
For CONUS. CONUS?
Yes, this is CONUS, yes. Cloud ceiling height, this was a request that came to us from the FAA. This uses METAROBS. We're only using a RAP-based background right now, and for that reason, we're putting this out as a separate file and calling it experimental. This was previously approved, and within our next upgrade in a few months, we plan to use HER for the background over the lower 48 and make it, I guess you would call it, fully operational. This is just a quick plot of what the ceiling analysis looks like. Again, it's a RAP-based background with ceiling observations from METARs put in. You can see some of the little spots here that are clearly coming from METAR observations.
So do you have a process to verify this in real time?
So
I understand it's a new product, but how is it being verified?
Well, we look at it, and because it's for analysis,
yeah.
So we use the cross-validation.
Yeah, okay.
Actually, we haven't turned the cross-validation on for ceiling, but that's what we will do.
Okay.
We were looking at it, comparing it to the lamp analysis.
All right. That my question is, you have a project that's going to be ongoing to assess the skill of this.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Through evaluation.
All right.
Feedback.
Thank you.
Made a few adjustments as well to the variational quality control. This alters the weight to a given observation based on its fit to the background and fits with other nearby observations. This is one example. I believe this is over Montana. We had what clearly was a bad temperature op get into the analysis here with the adjustments to the variational quality control. The bullseye is much less prevalent. Here are the cross-validation stats. And again, this is for the same 35-day period, 11th of July through the 14th of August. Surface temperature, you can see not much of a difference in the cross-validation stats, although we have been getting good feedback on that. For moisture and for wind, again, for moisture, not much of a difference there. For wind, this is an improvement of both the new background from the RAP and the HER, and also the new direct wind speed analysis method that we're using. Again, you see the differences aren't that great over the long term, but when we typically get cases from the field, they're individual cases that they want improvement on, and those cases have been improved upon for the most part. Total cloud amount, not much of a difference here, simply because for total cloud amount, so many of the observations come from the GOES imager, which has not changed. Wind gust, this needs to be explained. You can see for the old version, the error was a little bit lower, and for the new version, it is a little bit higher from 0Z to about 15Z. This is largely because of background differences in the new HER. And again, I have another slide in backup that that further explains this. There is an improvement with the new system from 15Z to 00Z about, but again, that degradation for whatever you want to call it is mostly coming from the HER. And again, we have another slide in backup to go over that. That's all I plan to present. I did put a lot of stuff in backup, but I was time limited here, so I wanted to just hit the high points.
Okay. Questions on the RTMA and IRMA or the NAMD and G changes? Questions on the phone? Okay.
Well,
go ahead.
Quick, this is Brian Rutsky. So just touching on that last point that Steve made, so has there been any communication to the GSD folks and EMC folks on what you're seeing with the wind gust and how to possibly address it, because if that's an issue in the RTMA IRMA, you're saying that it's an issue in the HER RAP as well.
This is something that we've just come to our attention within the past few days. So we've, you know, we'll obviously talk with GSD about it, but I'm not aware of any immediate solution.
Yeah, we'd be glad to work with you guys on that.
Okay, any other questions? Thank you. Okay. Next up, let's talk about the RAP and the HER.
So I got to ask. So it came to our attention the last couple of days. Because why?
When we process the statistics.
Okay. So what? I just don't understand the timing.
It was just large errors that connected to the period that we looked at. The next step is to continue to look at the stats and see if there are any differences.
And this is an existing parameter, right?
Yes.
Okay. So it's one parameter, but it's considerably worse now than it was before.
Well, it was worse for that period, I think, from 1Z to
15.
Right, for that 35-day period.
Yes.
Right, and that is improved from 15 to 23, I think.
Yeah.
So we don't know if this is a permanent feature.
Sure. But I guess the question was then, the point was raised, has this been communicated to the field so that they are aware? Because this is a big change in the characteristic of this one parameter. And again, I understand it was limited, but how do we notify them so that they understand this change in the parameter?
We already have a way to notify the field of changes. There's an email listserv. There's a VLAB page.
Okay.
There's lots of people monitoring it. But again, this is something that we just really found out about
okay.
this week.
I understand.
And you have to understand that most of the feedback we get from the field, which is what we pay most attention though, doesn't come from cross validation stats. It's this happened. Tell me why it's happened. Tell me what you're going to do to fix it.
All right.
And we just haven't gotten very much. We haven't gotten very much feedback recently on the gust analysis.
All right.
But you didn't see it in the results you did for the EMC CCCB?
I don't recall seeing that, no.
So, and again, I don't know how this gets communicated to the field or if it really needs to, and the field can decide how, you know, the SSDs might decide how to best to handle this. I know it's just one parameter, it's a feature.
We could update the TIN.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I was going to ask. However, Becky's saying, yes, we could update the TIN.
Just
another way to communicate with those who pick this field up off of NOAA port and would not necessarily be tapped into, you know, the Meg Sue team or the people that Steve deals with on a continuous basis.
I mean, I guess the hard thing to say, to know what to say is, well, it was bad for July. Wasn't bad back when you did the EMCCCB, so it may go away. It may.
Well, again, this is the first time GSD has heard about it, so we don't know if they have the ability to go back and look at their
We've talked test to them about the dust before, but not in the context of the RTMA, probably.
Okay, but is there a way to generate or pull out statistics on wind gust for other seasons from the test data that GSD might have? Because remember, we don't have that test data so much as they do. Sort of asking you, Stan.
Yeah, so I think we were aware that the wind gusts were stronger, but I think we helped me out, Jeff Mannequin, that we'd kind of looked at case studies and not seen anything that was particularly bad. We know that there is a difference in the way that the PBL height is calculated with the HERV V2 RAP V3 using TKE, and that's probably where this is coming from. But this is my first time to see we had statistics showing that overall we had an issue, but maybe I missed something there.
On a case study basis, we expressed some concern to GSD about a few cases with stronger gust. But I mean, some cases also looked better. So it's a different diagnostic and probably needs a little more examination.
All right.
Okay. Let's go on to Jeff Mannequin's going to talk about the RAP and the HER.
Okay. A long list of people to acknowledge, especially the GSD team, and in particular Curtis Alexander, who engaged in a lot of late-night phone calls with us hashing out some issues. I want to note Corey Gastini. This is his first implementation as a member of the RAPPER team, and it was a doozy, and he passed with flying colors. And also a big thanks to Zhao Shui. As you saw, we've given her a lot of changes late in the game, and this implementation is essentially two for the price of one. So she really did a fantastic job keeping everything going. Bill, you asked about reasons for the RAP expansion domain. You can see that we have a significantly larger domain. We've gone from the white to the green. Two things. We now provide coverage for Hawaii, which was requested. And more importantly, going forward, some ensemble plans have a RAP NAM configuration design. And essentially matching the NAM domain will make that feasible down the line. And also, for the next SHREF upgrade, hopefully, the when they initialize the ARW members off the RAP, they have to, in the current form, they have to kind of patch around the outside. This will improve their initialization. I'll hit the high points here with the data assimilation changes. We have greater weighting of the hybrid data assimilation in the RAP, and we're introducing it in the HER. We're starting cycling the land surface fields in the HER, whereas right now every run is essentially independent. We're adding in radial wind data and selected mesonet data, and we're increasing the applications of the assimilation of the radar reflectivity data, and overall improvement to the handling of surface obs and the adjustment of soil moisture. In terms of the model, we've moved to version 3.6.1 of the WRF ARW. Big changes to the PBL scheme and a modified wilting point for cropland and land surface model, which we'll see as a big player in improving some biases. Changes to the land surface model, big upgrade to the Thompson microphysics, changes to the shortwave and longwave radiation, improved 2-meter diagnostics for temperature and dew point, and in the RAP, improved convective scheme. Post-product changes, And a big thing right now, we in the wrap, we are eliminating all Grid 1 data and going to direct Grid 2 output data, except for a legacy grid to FAA that we are not yet able to turn off. We've added the accumulated snow depth and accumulated grapple in 1 hour and run total amounts to help the field with amounts of snowfall forecasts. As noted, we're extending the wrap from 18 to 21 hours and the HER from 15 to 18. We saw that the wrap domain now covers Hawaii. We're generating a specific grid that covers Hawaii and the Western Pacific. In terms of data going to AWIPS, we have a new wrap, or the Puerto Rico wrap grid is now going to AWIPS with this upgrade, and we have the sub-hourly HER output ready to go to AWIPS when they're ready. Now, there is some delay to the analysis products for both systems by a few minutes, but essentially we make up the time as the forecast goes out. So that by, like, I think it's like 12 hours in the HER and 15 in the RAP, we catch up to the times to where they currently are. But initially, the analysis products are a few minutes late in both.
The analysis being the FDR zero?
Correct. What we highlighted in the charter with what we hope to give the users was significant improvement to the pretty large warm-dry bias in the late afternoon in both the RAP and the HER, and the nighttime cold bias in the winter that's particularly significant over snowpack. And the idea was by mitigating that warm-dry bias during the late afternoon hours, you'd feedback, the PBL structure would be better, your instability forecast would be better, and those feedback to precip, reflectivity, and ceiling forecasts. With the addition of the hybrid analysis in the HER and the greater weighting in the RAP, we should get overall improved synoptics, and we expect improvements to the 10-meter winds. And this is a slide that we've shown you a bunch of times in the quarterly a science briefing, so I won't spend too much time on it, but it just makes the point that there's a lot of aspects or components of the model that are modified to attack that warm-dry bias, including the land surface model, the PBL scheme, the microphysics, GSI, and in the case of the RAP, the convective scheme, and the stats there on the left from the previous summer, and we have some updated ones coming, show on the top, with the operational wrap in red and the parallel in blue, reduction of the warm-dry bias in the late afternoon hours. And at the bottom, you can see the red curve showing the extreme dry bias in the operational version that in the blue line is significantly improved. I've done a number of RUC-RAP per implementations over the years, and I'm pretty gung-ho about this is one of the most impressive upgrade packages we've received in terms of really attacking a noted bias and really getting it. And that's shown here in the next few slides. This is an example, a sample, and you see this every day in the late afternoon hours of skin temperatures. On top is a HER forecast. On the operational bottom is the parallel. And your differences in the skin temperature here, you know, you've got large areas of 20, 25 degree Fahrenheit improvement, and that feeds back to 2 meters. Again, this I could pick almost any day this summer, and you'd see the same thing. On the top, you see a sample operational HER forecast of 2 meter temperature valid in the afternoon hours. The bottom's the parallel with color-coded obs on the right. And all through the southeast, mid-Atlantic, northeast, and even if you look closely over the upper Midwest, you can see the operational HER is running significantly too warm, and the parallel is a very clear improvement. And that feeds back to the dew point as well. This is a sample wrap here forecast about in the late afternoon, again, ops top, para bottom of 2 meter dew points, and the difference field on the right. And you can see that the changes here result in widespread differences of 8 to 15 degrees Fahrenheit, and in some cases over 20 degrees Fahrenheit for a 9-hour forecast. So that is a pretty massive difference. And if you look at the verification here on the right with the obs, if you look particularly over Nebraska and Kansas, You can see where the operational wrap on top has mixed things, the dew points out. You got lots of upper 40s, low 50s, where it's really in the low 70s. And you can see it over parts of the southeast as well. It's definitely a central and eastern issue, but again, you're mixing out the low-level moisture in the operational wrap in HER, and again, huge improvements in the parallel. And that feeds back, obviously, to instability. Here's sample 12-hour forecast of surface-based tape and the operational wrap on top and the operational HER on the bottom. And there's the parallel on the right, and here's the verification. And you can see the instability has all been wiped out in the operational versions on the left, and it's there in the parallel, and it matches up pretty well with what was observed. And this case study here of the Midwest derecho from last summer really shows how improving the problems with the overmixing feeds back to forecasts of convection. This example here on the left here, right at the start, these are 0 hour HER ops top para bottom analyses of composite reflectivity, and you can see the verification on the right. And if you look at the ops on top, you can see indications there across southern Minnesota, Iowa, northeast Nebraska down to Missouri of convection already kind of trying to get going at the start where it doesn't exist. And here's 1 hour later, and the top forecast, this is the problem. We mix out all the convective inhibition in the operational HER, and convection just erupts everywhere. And that you can see on top there, see lots of spurious convection because the verification's that little black box. Way too much spurious convection across southern Minnesota, northwest Iowa, southeast South Dakota, Missouri. And the parallel on the bottom is a very different forecast. And there's still a few spurious cells, notably in southeast South Dakota, but it's night and day difference. And if you look at forecast soundings, you can see what's going on. The top would be the analysis sounding for Sioux Falls, South Dakota, and the ops, the bottom, the parallel. And you can see on the top, you've essentially mixed that out. You have a much deeper PBL. You've removed a lot of the sin, and it's not hard for convection to get going, where the bottom sounding in the parallel is clearly not very close to generating convection. And sure enough, 1 hour later, that the sounding there on top went right into convection, formed all those spurious storms that you can see there in southeast South Dakota. The parallel is nowhere close to doing that. So that the system here, this ended up as a big organized bow echo system that, because the operational forecast generated too much widespread convection everywhere, it couldn't then organize the system properly. And so you can see it at 2 hours in, the observed radar there in the black box shows things starting to organize over central Minnesota. The operation on top, again, has way too much convection going everywhere, and the bottom keeps things to where they are. And then by 5 hours into the forecast in that black box, you can see an organized forward propagating MCS with wind damage across Minnesota, Wisconsin. The top there, the operational HER, is focused more in Iowa and has a messy convective mode over Minnesota. The parallel on the bottom correctly has a organized system, and that lingers on with time. Again, 8 hours in, and then 14 hours in, the evolution in the para is quite good because, again, it suppressed the spurious convection and allowed the organized to allowed the real stuff to evolve properly. And we saw another system this summer that behaved in pretty much the same way between ops and para. Another example here, these are some cases that the GSD has accumulated over the years. Two cases on top, two observation maps from two cases. And if you look at the bottom forecast, the operational, again, you can see too much convection initiated that doesn't exist. And the parallels in the middle eliminate a lot of that spurious convection. Real quick here, there's some parallel HER forecast that Corey Gassini put together. If I from the historic West Virginia flooding, the verifications in the lower right. The verification time doesn't totally match up with the each of the forecasts since it's kind of a running period, but essentially all these HURA parallel forecasts kind of focused in on potential for extreme rainfall amounts in south-central West Virginia where they occurred. I'm going to try and zip through here so I can get to the stats in a couple minutes that I have. We had a winter case that showed better precip in the big blizzard last winter. It reduced precip southeast of I-95 is correct. The analysis improvement here, this is an example from a few weeks ago. Ops left, para right of 2-meter dew points, and you can see on the New York-Pennsylvania border a big blob of low dew points where a bad ob, it was I think it was a METAR station, or AWAS, got in to the ops. The parallel, since it's assimilating more data, more mesonets, the influence of one ob is lessened. Better improved 2-meter diagnostic leads to a better guess, and we have a better chance to eliminate the impact of some of these bad obs. What?
Yeah, you used 13 a month.
Okay, I said 1 minute.
Yeah.
I said 5, I'm sorry. I thought you said 1 minute.
You wasted one now. Go.
Yeah. some stats here that our newest team member, Ben Blake, generated. This is bias in RMS in the east. From the comparing the ops wrap in red and the para in blue. And if you see the triangles are going to be the bias and the dots are going to be the RMS. In the upper left, the reduced warm bias, is especially in the late afternoon hours, is pretty clear. The reduced dry bias in the lower left with the big mountain there of showing the dry bias in the late afternoon hours, that's greatly reduced in the parallel. And then the wind speed, the ops right now has a bit of a fast bias, and that is reduced at all times a day. These are forecast and observed means. So this is the data averaged out over the whole domain. Obs in black, so you want to be close to the black line. Ops red, para blue. And again, it just kind of makes the same points that we are eliminating a lot of the warm bias, especially in the late afternoon hours, and the dry bias, and the wind speed improvement there in the lower right is pretty clear. Now here's, a lot of these changes are targeted towards the west, toward the east, so they're not as pronounced in the west, but still there. We are still reducing the warm bias in the west, and the dry bias, it's not as pronounced as it is in the east, but it's still a notable improvement. The winds were not nearly as sort of fast bias to begin with, so that's kind of a mixed bag there in the lower right corner. And I'll had the same thing for the forecast and observed means, but the same story is told there. I want to get to a few quick precip stats. I'll just show real quick. These are 2-meter temperature warning stats in the east and the west, and valid at 12Z from GSD stats last winter. And you can see the west runs a bit warm in the early morning in the ops, and that's reduced a bit. And the cold bias in the east is also reduced a bit. These are stats of 3-hour equitable threat score and bias. Again, we have both the west and the east. We see improvement in the threat scores. And in the early hours in particular, there's a really high bias in both the east and the west that is reduced in early hours. At later hours, perhaps the bias is a little bit lower in the or further away from one in the parallel version compared to the ops. But again, the big reduction of that spurious convection early on really shows up here in the reduction of bias. And we can make the same case here if we look at verification of reflectivity. Skill score on the left and bias on the right. And on the right in particular, if you look at the bias for, I think this is 25 dBz, The very high bias in the red line on the right is reduced quite a bit in the parallel, although it's still a high bias. We still have a ways to go. We're still, especially in the weekly force events, as was noted, some of the evaluations, we still have a ways to go to eliminate the initiation, some of those events. But again, overall, the big complaint in the HER in particular has been that we generate too much widespread convection, and by getting the PBL structure better, we bring down those biases a lot in this upgrade. And I'll stop there.
All right, questions for Jeff on the RAP or the HER? No? Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, now I want to go through the various feedback we received, and then I'll ask if others have comments. And like I said, I know some of you sent stuff on the RTMA and IRMA, some on the RAP and HER, some on both. So when it's your turn, please speak about whatever you would like to speak about. So I'm going to start with AWC. Did we have somebody from AWC join?
Hi, this is Joshua Scheck.
Hello, Josh. What would you like to tell us about the RAP and HER?
I'll tell you what, I can save us time, and you don't even really have to look at the diagrams. But I can speak to the slides if you'd like.
Your call. Give us about five minutes feedback.
Well, we conducted the HER evaluation. You could go to the next slide. Our main focus, since we're talking about convection allowing, was reflectivity and echo top values, and that's largely because those are tied to the CCFP, which is an automated product. So to sum up, better 30 dBZ and 30,000 foot echo top scores over the central CONUS, which has been a little bit of an issue. There's not a lot of change in the Northeast, but there is a decrease in convective echo top and reflectivity bias, which is a positive thing that reduces our false alarms. There's a general increase in skill on CONUS level using those two parameters, and something this slide doesn't say that the following slides we sort of left out. Also, we absolutely need the 3D cloud fractions that this will make operational. So we very much support the implementation of HER V2. Those 3D cloud fractions allow us to derive the actual cloud layers, which are a requirement from FAA that we're providing. So with this, we have an operational way to do that in a very high resolution, better verifying way. So less than 5 minutes. Any questions?
No, but your point about the CCFP is really important. So it will begin to use the new HER once it goes in, right?
Yeah, the code's already written. We've been running them in parallel. We don't back up our data archives, so we did lose some data, but we had enough to do this assessment. And it's absolutely ready. As soon as the implementation goes, we just update a script.
All right, and so everybody that works on the cause is aware of the change and will expect that change in characteristic of the CCFP.
They will once we have confirmation that we're moving forward, but yes.
Okay, very good.
Yes, thanks, Bill.
Thanks.
Okay, anything else, Josh?
No, ma'am. Thanks for the time.
Thanks, Josh.
No, and the intimidation factor is for me and the developers here. We want to hear from you guys on the phone. That's why the intimidation on them is so we can get to you guys and hear what you have to say. So that doesn't mean you get like 45 minutes. All right, WPG.
Oh.
You're next.
I didn't put any slides up.
That's okay.
Basically, from the IRMA timescale, we were very appreciative of the different changes in the dry bias. Also, the wind speed that helps out with our bias correction of any of our products that go out, from especially the medium range, so we can, IRMA's better wind speed analysis actually helps out quite a bit for us with our products, especially in the medium range. because we don't do wind short term, but the IRMA in the short term as well helps out with recognizing where convection and things like that may start, so the dew points and temperatures. So that helps out quite a bit. With the HER, there was a lot of look at some of the convective outputs. Basically, a lot of forecasters said, well, it worked really great sometimes, and then, you know, case-by-case type scenario. The biggest compliment was the fact that, as you noted, with the convection not starting up as quickly, and especially noted during, you know, when there was cold pools, definitely present, you can definitely tell that was doing a lot better with convective initiation and everything. So, and that's in the dry and wet effects again.
All right,
from us.
So thumbs up from you.
Thumbs
right?
up from
all right.
Yeah, we wholeheartedly go for it.
Okay.
We don't normally look at wind gusts, so I mean we didn't notice any, we didn't boil anything, and I think that's probably why you're not seeing a lot of cases in that, because a lot of people don't look at the wind gust IRMA field.
Was this evaluated during the any of your HMT experiments?
The HER experimental was, and it was used during some of the. We're doing our final report for that right now, so I really can't go into.
Oh, I'm just curious if you.
Yeah.
Okay.
We did use the HER experimental for that.
All right. Thanks, Jim.
Thank you, Jim. All right, Israel, you're next.
Okay.
Press P.
Yeah, you can go to the next slide. So, we've had a long time to look at RAP V3, HER V2 provided early from GSD. So we've had over two warm seasons to look at the improvements in these versions. For the RAP, we looked at focused on our mesoscale analysis fields, forecast sounding structure, to show an example of that. For the HER, we looked at reflectivity forecast, primarily location, structure, initiation, that type of thing, and I have some objective verification stats of that as well. Go to the next slide. Shows one of our forecasts has put together a comparison of our mesoscale analysis field based on both the RAP V2 and RAP V3 and compared that to observed soundings from June of last year to March of this year. And most of the severe weather parameters had very similar error statistics between both RAP versions. One of the fields that showed a little bit more of a difference was MLK, and that's the plot shown at the bottom. The RAP V2 showed a little bit of a high bias in MLK in terms of an analysis, where the RAP V3 is lower improved bias than that. So that looks like a general improvement for that field. So that was a good finding. Next slide. It's been talked about the improvement of the warm dry bias. This is the recent sounding example. A RAP V2, 12-hour forecast sounding valid at 0Z in August 15th. On the left, you can see the overmixed boundary layer 91 over 41 temperature over dew point, where observed was 81 over 67. The RAP V3 forecast valid at the same time is much improved boundary layer depth, temperature, dew point, structure there. So just highlighting the types of improvement. Those types of improvements are fairly easy to find in the summertime. Next slide. Focus on some of the HER results. So as I mentioned, we've been looking at this version of the HER V2 for a long time. We looked at it even last spring, 2015, in the hazardous weather test bed. We compared the operational HER to this HER-X, and this is participant results. Is the HER-X better or worse for, you know, given mesoscale area of interest that we're looking at? And in almost every case, it was at least as good as, and about half the time a little bit better than the operational HER in last spring experiment when we looked at it. Next slide shows some of the cases where it was rated better. The top case is May 20th of 2015. Bottom row is May 14th of 2015. The HER, operational HERs on the left, the experimental HER in the middle, and observations on the right. And often you can see the ratings just be improved lack of or holding off on any convective initiation. So you're not getting the spurious storms or getting initiation too early, that type of thing. That's how the type of cases where it was rated better in the experimental HER. go to the next slide, show some more recent cases where we see improved convective initiation forecasts. Again, the operational HERs on the left, experimental HER in the middle, and observations on the right. You can see, again, you're just improved boundary layer structure, so you're not getting spurious convective initiation. And so, again, these are pretty common, and you can find these pretty often in the warm season. Next slide. So there are improvements. There still are some challenges, certainly in weekly force situations, where both, this example shows where both HER versions maintain MCSs when in reality they dissipate. Top row shows the initiation, so they're both starting off with a similar type of convective structure, and in both, in the bottom row, it's a six-hour forecast. They both maintain an MCS, where in reality on the bottom right, MCS actually dissipated. Go to the next slide. Another weekly force case in July where both versions, they start out similar on the top row there, but 6 hours later, again, have spurious initiation of storms. And in bottom right, there was nothing in observations. And next slide, another case, again, late July. These were three subsequent days. Again, they both start off similarly in the top row of the analysis. Bottom row shows some spurious initiation, northern Illinois. It's a little bit improved in the bottom middle and the experimental HER. And then the convection associated with an MCV coming out of eastern Ohio into western PA isn't particularly well organized. You go to the next slide, it shows that there was severe reports associated with that organized convection in western PA and Pittsburgh's area in that day. So, again, neither version handled that organized convection very well there. So, again, weekly force cases or mesoscale force things pretty difficult still for the HER and the HER-X at this point. Next slide shows some neighborhood verification of reflectivity, composite reflectivity. The experimental HER-HER-V2s in blue, the operational HERs in green, shown at 30, 40, and 50 dBZ reflectivity threshold. This is a performance diagram, and you can, this is from May 1st through mid-August, the 15Z cycle for all forecast hours. And you can see, you want to be closer to the upper right portion of the diagram. You have an improvement in the CSI at all reflectivity thresholds. And specifically at 30 dBZ, your improvement is mainly a reduced false alarm ratio. And at 40 and 50 dBZ, the blue boxes are above the green. It's mainly an improvement in the POD at those thresholds. Next slide. I wanted to see if I could show statistically the improvement in convective initiation or holding off on spurious convective initiation. So I looked at shorter range forecasts, just forecast hour 1 through forecast hour 4 at a later time, 18Z cycle. And you can see what the difference is in the blue. The HER-V2 basically shows are the 30 and 40 dBZ, especially boxes, are to the right of the green boxes. And that's just basically a reduced false alarm ratio and reduced frequency bias. So I think that highlights, again, the improvement in reduced spurious convective initiation. And, again, this was the warm season of this year. Next slide. So in summary, notable warm dry bias and forecasts of the warm season PBAL from the RAP and HER has been improved in the RAP V3 and HER V2. HER V2 at times provides improved reflectivity forecasts in terms of initiation, coverage, location, intensity over the operational HER. However, in weekly force situations or with subtle mesoscale forcing, HER versions can both exhibit similar storm forecast errors. And we're going to continue to interact with those at GSD and toward working further improvements in future versions of the RAP and HER. And we improve RAP V3 and HER V2 for implementation.
All
any
right.
Questions?
Nope. Thank you very much, Israel.
Thank you.
Okay. Eastern Region, Brian, any comments?
I don't know if you have what we brought up, but starting with the HER, we got a variety of comments from our students back, and, you know, it was basically all positive, noticing some of the same things that other folks have noticed already. And again, that is important for us from a perspective of convection, aviation, fire weather, all these things. These improvements will benefit us. We did note, again, you know, as long as the forecast offices have the ability to look at this data via the SBN and AWIPS, and I know there's some movement, as Becky mentioned, on that, but the full set of information would allow our forecasters to really make use of everything that's being generated at NSEP, and the only way to do that is via the SBN and AWIPS. If you scroll down, I think that's most of it, but there was one example, I believe, that I included at the end, just showing from a recent forecast how the parallel was much closer to the observed dew point. And again, as people have been showing with the mixing and other things like that, seems like the boundary layer is much better represented in the parallel her. So I think that's so we definitely implement as proposed for improved implementation for the her. And I don't know if you have the RTMA IRMA thing about something.
There it is, sorry. No, that was the one. Hold on, Brian. There it is. Okay. Go ahead.
Yeah. And if you scroll down to some of our general comments, stop right there. The new terrain land sea mask, I know I've been involved with that a lot. And that's something to note, that it's still a work in progress, but this is the start of that work in progress, collaborating with the RTMA and IRMA and the Blend folks on that, so that's good. The cloud ceiling height, we want to add that we feel like this is a requirement not just for the FAA, but also requirements for each region and typically all the weather service, especially as digital aviation becomes more important. So we definitely need the RTMA as a source of verification. So it should not just be an FAA requirement. It should be a weather service requirement as well. The improvements, you know, we noted that the background has generally led to improvements, but we hadn't seen the wind gust validation, and we mostly did qualitative validation through our offices. But we also look forward to further work on the observational QC and process by which that is done, because that's a fairly important thing that still has yet to be addressed. And then the example that I provided was an example related to the case that Steve was showing, that the parallel IRMA does a much better job with wind speed and weft and not having bullseyes like the one that's present over the Charleston, West Virginia area. So again, we approve the RTMA IRMA as proposed.
Great. Thank you, Brian. Okay, Dave Myrick.
Good morning. Good afternoon, everyone. All right, while Becky's pulling that up, the RTMA IRMA upgrade, this is an important piece of the upcoming National Blend of Models implementation. We're currently using the version that just went through its 30-day test in our parallel testing for this upgrade for the National Blend. We needed the Hawaii and Puerto Rico IRMA grids. The Unified Terrain, as Brian talked about, is also in there. In addition, one of the things that was added was new ceiling grids, and we're using those as a part of our development for Blend version 3. So those are much appreciated. Brian did talk about the challenges that have been identified with the Unified Terrain, and that this will be an ongoing effort to get this right, so I won't belabor that point. We appreciate, again, the Hawaii and Puerto Rico additions. One thing over the last several weeks we've noticed as we've looked at the Puerto Rico a little bit more closely, it appears as though the terrain, there's a lot more terrain detail in the temperature and dew point grids when compared side by side with the NDFD grids. So that's something that will need to be investigated as future enhancements are done. I mentioned the cloud ceiling height, and we didn't see any evidence of degradation. I mean, we've been using these, using all of the IRMA grids as a part of the National Blend Project. They're a key component in our calibration and bias correction process. So MDL recommends that we go ahead with the implementation.
Okay.
All right. Thanks, Dave.
Thank you, Dave. Has Gene Petrescu joined us? He didn't think he'd be able to. Okay, so he sent in some feedback from Alaska. Tony Eccles from climate.com. Are you?
Yes, good morning. Good afternoon, sorry.
Good morning.
Can you hear me okay?
Uh-huh.
Okay. Okay, so thank you very much for letting me participate in this evaluation. And I just want to say thank you from everyone in the private sector that you guys are doing an awesome job. We love this data. We love the improvements, and it allows us to really pass on value and make money. So thank you very much. So my evaluation was focused,
by the way. That's a great example. You need to talk about that in public places. How we are supporting the private industry to help you make money and spawn the economy.
Yeah. If you ever want us to give you material like that, to put in your brief.
Oh, I don't want you need to. When you go to talk to people that make decisions, you provide that information.
Well, we will. We will. I'm just saying, if you want more things that stick in your briefings, we can give it to you, too.
All right. Thanks, Tony.
Okay, anyway, let's just skip forward a couple slides. We can go over the preamble stuff. Yeah. Okay, I just want to show the verification grid is mostly Corn Belt, and the key thing there is since I'm using radar mosaics as ground truth, you always got to be careful that, that's going to introduce a wet bias because the HERV reflectivity, obviously, you're seeing it everywhere, but you're going to miss some, even with good coverage. So you expect to see a little bit of a wet bias all the time. Okay, next slide. Let's just go forward one more. Okay, so my overall results confirm a lot of things that I've been saying that, we saw an overall improvement. So HERV V2 is in red. So in the lower right in CSI, you can see we got significant improvements, particularly at the first half of the forecast. It kind of piddles out the end there. And most of that is coming from, the lack of the removal of the spurious convection and also the big development of MCSs that can happen. So you see in the lower left in the bias, HERV V2 actually looks like it's initializing a little bit on the wet side. Crashing down, and then it goes crazy, just like the operational HER in overproducing convection too early. But the good news is that it mellows out really fast, much faster than the operational. That's what's getting rid of all of those MCSs or spurious convection. And you see it goes down to a bias of about 0.1. That's still really wet, but I think most of that can be explained by the fact that radar, which is missing some. So that could actually be no bias by the time you get to about 9 hours. Okay, but you get a little more insights as you go to breakout by cycle. Go to the next slide. So these are the same stats. Now going cycle by cycle over 2 days. If we flip to the next slide. Here we go. Okay, so this is by cycle, same stats. Oh, back up one, please. Yeah, and the lower plot is the rate of occurrence. In other words, we're using twin DBZs, so this is the amount of area of that subdomain that's actually wet. So you can separate out quickly the wet cases versus the dry. And then the other neat thing is to look at the bias, and the black line is persistence. So that gives you a really quick look at is the convection ramping up or is it dissipating? So you can see what kind of day it is. So we're picking out three different cases here, A, B, and C, where one by CSI was a tie, so you did get much improvement. The B case is a big win. And it's actually just a case where, it didn't gin up a big MCS. And then the C case is the one I'll focus on real quick because it shows something different. And that's a case where you can see the persistence was on the wet side, which means it was a dissipation case. But the overall story by win-loss tie is that, HERV V2 is kicking butt. It's doing better about half the time tie maybe 30-40% of the time and maybe slightly worse 10% of the time. Okay, if you click forward to, let's just skip forward to the last case in the interest of time. Keep going.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, just go to the case C. Okay, so here's a case where there was a lot, this is at the 6-hour point. Sorry, you can't show loops here because I couldn't get them across. But there was a whole bunch of dissipation going on from Missouri all the way into Indiana. And what happened in the operational HER is that it was able to get the dissipation fairly well, where HER2 sort of hung onto it a little bit too much. That's where it did worse. And also, looking in Kansas, where, again, you see over-prediction by the operational HER, at least it had it in the right place. So it caught, it got all the hits that it needed to, where the HER2 was a little bit off in there. So that's why it ended up doing worse. And this was, again, it's not the prevalent case, but it shows maybe an area to look for improvement. Any questions?
No, I appreciate you doing this, Tony. It's useful for us, and I fully appreciate the way you use it in your business. That's an important thing to know.
Okay. You're welcome, Bill.
Thanks.
All right. Those were the things. Did anybody else send me the memo or presentation that I haven't pulled up?
Hey, Becky. This is Brian from Eastern. Just one more comment that I had forgotten. In the HER eval, it had asked about a seasonal thing. Is the nighttime cold bias over snow cover reduced? Just to mention, again, we weren't really able to confirm that via this upgrade, but we had seen in prior, looking at the parallel data in prior times during the last winter, that it seemed like it was, but it, just in terms of the question that was asked, it might be worthwhile to provide some information on that next time as opposed to asking a question that we can't really confirm directly.
Okay. No, good point. Thanks, Brian. Central region. John or Jeff, any comments?
John, were you going to talk or should I?
No, go ahead. I didn't have anything more than what we know already.
Okay, yeah. So basically just confirming everything that we've heard. I think both of them are solid thumbs up. All the comments were essentially positive. Anytime someone mentioned something about either Irma, RTMA, or REP, it was always an improvement. A couple things I wanted to point out. One is the RAP soundings are going to be key for Forecast Builder this winter. Because of what's disseminated, we can't use the HER sound top-down because we don't get enough data top-down. So we use the RAP very heavily for these precip type top-down algorithms that Dan Baumgart and Andy Just and everybody are working on. So those are key. And what I heard, they will be transmitted the extra few hours on both. In terms of the hourlies, the additional 3 hours will be transmitted on SBN almost immediately, which is good. And another thing that we need to talk about, and I just touch on for about 30 seconds, is what I thought I heard is that the wind gusts have improved on the Irma RTMA for the daytime hours, but there's some degradation at night. Is that correct?
Yeah, that was basically what our stats showed, yes.
Okay, great. Something else that's something we need to discuss going forward, and this isn't the forum, but what forecasters often forecast in a wind gust grid, but not always, is the peak wind for the hour. So, it's we're often forecast, or these analyses are probably adjusted to the gust at the top of the hour. Well, that's not typically what we do anyway. So I think it's something that we need to discuss going forward from a big picture item. But other than that, I'd say it's thumbs up on both, and we are really impressed with the improvements all across the board on everything. Thank you.
Thanks, Jeff.
Thanks, Jeff.
Andy, any Western region?
Real quick comment for Steve.
Yeah, hey, thank you, guys.
One sec, Andy. Hold on.
We do have a max
10-meter wind speed over the previous hour that comes out of the RAP, or it comes out of the HER, I think it comes out of the RAP, may come out of the NAM nest as well. So that may be something we want to work with.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay, go ahead, Andy.
All right, so, yeah, we're running long. I won't repeat everything that's been said. By the way, SBC, great analysis at the very beginning. We've been sending in all our input on the HER and RTMA as it comes in. Basically, the bottom line is, you know, I talked to the field quite a bit, and the HER upgrade, this is something I've been waiting for. So it's not perfect, but it's certainly, you know, the folks in OER are being aggressive and are making a lot of progress, and we're looking forward to this upgrade. The RTMA is clearly still a work in progress. It's, as we talked about before, it's a key component, I think the most critical component of the NBM effort, and it still has a lot of words. So we very much support this next upgrade. But as we talked about before, if there's ways we can get more resources to this project over the next year or two, that would be great because there's still a lot of things that need to be fixed. Since we got everybody on the phone, one of the issues with the RTMA is what is good enough? We're getting a lot of comments. You know, we have folks out there who think the RTMA ought to match to within a half a degree of the ASOSes and whatnot. So we have formed a Sioux team. Dave Myrick can give you more details if you want. Dave Bernhardt is leading that and trying to come up with a position paper based on good science on what is it, basically what is a good enough analysis. So as we get these comments, we can adjudicate them against this policy and decide where should we focus and what is maybe an educational thing that we have to do at our offices. But we fully support moving forward on both these projects. Thumbs up.
Thank you, Andy.
Thanks, Andy.
Anybody else on the phone or in the room have any feedback they want to provide? Okay, that's what we have for you.
All right. When is it scheduled to go in?
It's scheduled to go in next Tuesday. I will say, given the time of year, if we got into a critical weather situation, I have a staffing reason I couldn't push it to the week of the 29th. It would have to push into September. But it is going to be clear and sunny and wonderful, so it will be next Tuesday.
All right. So just a couple of things. First of all, these are all going in. This was an excellent briefing. These are high-quality upgrades to the major modeling systems that we have, and the analysis, of course, with the National Blend of Models. A lot of work has gone into it. I fully appreciate the field and Tony, the amount of effort that went into the analysis. And again, I know it's becoming part of your everyday business practice to look at these things. And so I fully appreciate that. So I come into this meeting with a high level of confidence that what we're putting out is really a significantly improved package. And that's what standards are all about. So I commend, you know, the RTMA, IRMA team, you know, the RAP, the HER, you know, EMC and NCO for all working together on these projects. It's a big deal.
And
GSD. I said RAP and HER. GSD, of course. But it is. It's a team effort. And, you know, this is what it's all about. So, really, I'm proud of everybody. It's a heck of an accomplishment. And I'm more than happy to sign off on that document. So, well done, everyone.
Glad to.
All right, Becky, back to you.
All right. Well, if there's nothing else, that's it. Thank you, everybody, and have a nice weekend.